We are here to present a new robot control environment with a new powerful language and runtime, Juliet and Romeo. The origin of Juliet and Romeo comes from several decades of research and industry experience from Cognibotics and Esten Automation. Esten Automation founders and Cognibotics founders had visions of enabling new technologies in industrial robotics before having met. And when they did meet in 2015, their ideas aligned for a new product. The first 3 years of the development was about finding requirements and possible technical solutions. Early on, Julia was favored as the language itself has most of the required features and more. However, some of the requirements, such as having real-time garbage collection, raised some uncertainties for using Julia as is. After investigating further, it was decided to make a new language as close to Julia as possible. The language should use static typing for predictability, bytecode as intermediate format to fulfill user needs for interactive motion programming, real-time garbage collection, and a Romeo runtime designed for consistent low latency and preemptive multitasking. The requirement to stay as close to Julia syntax as possible is important and is only broken if predictability would be compromised. An important feature for Juliet is to be able to save as Julia to then run in the Julia environment instead. Juliet and Romeo are targeting the real-time domain for controlling robots and other machines, and Julia has powerful packages and libraries for digital twins and AI models, which is important in modern automation. This is Juliet. To the left, we have a Juliet program, and to the right, we have a robot simulation extension. The extension is showing an ER20 Esten robot. A motion kernel is feeding the simulation positional data. However, the positions will not be updated unless the motion kernel is being fed with new motion commands. These commands will be sent by the Juliet program. Juliet can be started either in run or debug mode. Stepping over the first function will initialize the connection between the program and the motion kernel. Stepping over the second function will initialize the connection between Juliet and the simulation. Now, going inside MoveRobot will show one of the few syntactic differences between Juliet and Julia, which is the var keyword. In Juliet, variables must be declared before being used. Since we are in debug mode, it is possible to set breakpoints. Running to this breakpoint will show that we have a program pointer as well as a motion pointer, marked by this robot icon. In the simulation, we can manually set a trace. Adding another breakpoint and running to that point now looks like the robot is drawing something. It is not uncommon for a robot operator to wish to change the code in an already running program. For example, there seems to be a line missing to fill this path. In Juliet, you can add modifications to your program without losing the current state. This kind of editing in a stop state allows for more complicated code changes, such as adding new functions. Now, the tool center point color is changed, and I would like to execute the motions backwards. This is possible in Juliet, because the motion library has defined behavior for backwards execution of the MoveJ function. This is entirely expressed in Juliet, and that is possible due to Romeo runtime support. The last function in main will draw the three circles of the Julia logo. In this function, you can tell another difference from Julia, which is that variables can be declared without being initialized. The circles will be drawn in an infinite loop by first moving the robot linearly to the top position of each circle, followed by drawing the outline of the circle before filling it with a helper function. Note that the linear movement MoveL has a keyword argument onFinish. This argument is a function which will be called whenever the motion finishes. The onFinish function will be executed asynchronously. However, if I add a breakpoint to the last line inside the while loop, you may notice that the program pointer does not stop there immediately. This is because the last motion instruction inside fill circle will block the current task until the purple circle is done filling, due to this sync flag. The kind of language features that Julia provides is unheard of in the robot programming world. This is why Julia is such an inspiration to Juliet.
For predictable runtime performance, we required static typing, and the compiler should specialize as many function calls as possible. This is to avoid unpredictable dynamic dispatch at runtime. Note that type declarations are optional in Julia, but in Juliet, type declarations are required in certain cases. In Juliet, we also wanted static checking of variable declarations to remove avoidable runtime errors due to undefined or unassigned variables. Another important requirement was fast incremental compilation and code loading. These requirements all led us to create the Juliet compiler from the ground up to support static compilation and incremental code generation. The compiler supports type inference, and the type system is very similar to Julia. The main differences being that we require static types, and all variables must be declared before used. Unlike Julia, we do not use LLVM, and there is no runtime code generation. Everything is statically compiled. In a few cases, dynamic type checks are required in runtime code, but we try to limit this as much as possible. The Juliet compiler supports macros and has a REPL. The Juliet REPL is useful for exploring the language. Here we declare a variable and do some computations. Let's print the result. Let's write a simple for loop. The Juliet REPL has a command history you can navigate using the arrow keys. Here we declare a function that doubles the input. The Romeo virtual machine has a real-time garbage collector designed to minimize latency and jitter in high-priority tasks. The fundamental principle, semi-concurrent GC scheduling, is that the memory management is organized so that work done in line with application tasks is kept to a minimum. The most part of the GC work is scheduled with a lower priority than the timing-critical tasks. By using fine-grained incremental GC, a high-priority task can interrupt the GC with very low latency. The measurements shown are the lengths of such GC increments on a Linux machine with an Intel Core i5 CPU running at 2.5 GHz. This is the GC times for an entire run of a multi-threaded Juliet application. Zooming in, we see that the vast majority of increments are below 1 microsecond, 0.12% of increments took more than 2 microseconds, and the longest increment in this execution was 8.3 microseconds. This indicates that the worst case latency caused by the GC can be kept below 10 microseconds. That's all, folks.